Morning. We'll be starting today on renal cell carcinoma, which is the most common solid malignant tumor of kidney in adults. And it renal cell carcinoma. Isme unki awaaz bhi aa rahi hai. Which is a primarily a surgical disease. ठीक है बंद हो गई
हो गया।
हाँ सो रिनल सेल कार्सिनोमा सिनोनिम्स आर क्लियर सेल कार्सिनोमा एडिनो कार्सिनोमा ऑफ किडनी ग्रेविट्स ट्यूमर दिस ऑल यू नो हाइपर नेफ्रोमा इंटरनिस ट्यूमर एंड द प्रिफर्ड एंड मोस्ट कॉमनली यूज इज आरसीसी और रिनल सेल कार्सिनोमा सो renal cell carcinoma can be a referral from any specialist because it presents with myriads of symptoms. One of the common symptoms is PUO, pyrexia of unknown origin, fever of unknown cause, hypertension and anemia. So a medicine guy can refer this patient when he evaluates for fever, hypertension or anemia. It can be a referral from a hematologist because patient may present with polycythemia. Patient may have pathological fracture of bones, so he can go to orthopedic surgeon and he can then later diagnose it as RCC by investigating it. It can be presented as nephrotic syndrome, so he can go to a nephrologist. It can present with abnormal liver function test like Stauffer syndrome, which we'll be discussing later. So he can go to a gastro specialist. It can present with pulsatile metastatic deposits. It can present with a neuromyopathy. It can present as weight loss, raised ESR and lung lesions. So it can mimic like tuberculosis and you can go to a chest physician.
Participants in the conference.
एक बार निकाल के ले आऊँ क्या?
हाँ, सर बोलिए।
हो गया क्या?
बोलिए इसमें।
आ रही है अभी आवाज़ आ रही
है? आ रही है।
अभी आ रही है आवाज़?
आ रही क्या सर? नहीं आ रही।
नहीं आ रही
है। रुकिए सर।
So today we'll be discussing about renal cell carcinoma. The most common solid malignant tumor of kidney in adults which is primarily a surgical disease. So synonymous. Was that enough? Achha. Synonymously, it is also known as clear cell carcinoma because it was believed to arise from clear cells, adenocarcinoma, Gravitt's tumor, hypernephroma, internist tumor, because it presents with myriads of symptoms, and now preferably and commonly it should be referred as renal cell carcinoma. So it, as I told you, it can be a referral from any specialist. It can present with a fever, PUO, pyrexia of unknown origin, hypertension, anemia, polycythemia, pathological fractures of bone, nephrotic syndrome, deranged abnormal liver function test as in Stauffer syndrome, pulsatile metastatic deposits, neuromyopathy, weight loss, lung lesions, raised ESR, can mimic like a tuberculosis in these finding and can present to a chest physician, CNS metastasis or hypercalcemia. So what is the cell of origin? As it was thought previously, proximal convoluted tubules were the considered as cell of origin, but with further investigations, histopathology of various renal cell subtypes, it can arise from various parts of nephron and can give rise to different subtypes of renal cell carcinoma, each having a unique genetic basis and tumor biology. So PCT is not alone the site of origin. The most common is PCT. Yes. So what is oncogenesis of renal cell carcinoma? The most common etiological factor, as you know, is tobacco chewing, smoking. Various viruses have been implicated, lead compounds, many chemical carcinogens, radiation is one of the factor, end-stage renal disease is one of the triggering factor for oncogenesis to RCC, and various genetic abnormalities like von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. These are the various basic oncogenesis of renal cell carcinoma. So what are the special attributes of RCC? It is highly immunogenic. It generates very, very rich immunogenetic response in the body of host. It is very vascular, highly vascular, angiogenesis. It is refractory. It has a multi-drug resistant protein. It is a refractory tumor to drugs. That's why chemotherapy is not helpful in renal cell carcinoma. These are the because of immunogenicity and multi-drug resistance protein, the chemotherapy is not helpful. Any chemotherapy, conventional chemotherapy, they are not useful in renal cell carcinoma. It is highly vascular. It has a regulated growth by cell cycle regulation of growth factors and signal transduction. So these things, the most important thing you should know is very immunogenic, vascular and refractory because of multi-drug resistance protein. So what are the familial? So as you know, all malignancy have a sporadic form and a familial form. Most commonly, most likely 80% will be sporadic, 10 to 15% are familial renal cell carcinoma. So in familial, what are the main subtypes are? One is VHL or von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, in short term of chromosome 3. So it can present as a syndrome of CNS hemangioblastoma, retinal angioma, pheochromocytoma, pancreatic tumors, epididymal cyst and endolymphatic cystic tumors. So these are the various presentations present in VHL syndrome. The other form of familial is hereditary papillary RCC, familial leiomyomatosis, which can present with RCC and multiple cutaneous and uterine leiomyoma. Then Bird-Hogg-Dupe syndrome, which presents as RCC plus cutaneous fibrofolliculomas, lung cyst. These lung cysts can rupture and lead to pneumothorax. So what is that oncogenesis? Tumor suppressor gene on chromosome 3, also called as VHL gene, short term of chromosome 3, 3P, also known as VHL gene. Then degradation of hypoxia inducible factor alpha. It is found in all VHL syndromes and 90% of sporadic RCC. So even in sporadic RCC, this factor is very important. So loss of VHL gene, hypoxia inducible factor alpha will accumulate, and this accumulation of HIF will lead to increase in vascular endothelial growth factor and platelet derived growth factor, which will bind to tyrosine kinase receptor, and then further it will promote proliferation of cell, migration, their survival and angiogenesis. So what happens, since chemotherapy was not used, these finding led to new treatment which is known as TKI inhibitors, tyrosine kinase receptor inhibitors, TKIs, tyrosine kinase receptor inhibitors like sunitinib, sorafenib. These new drugs now are helpful in management of few forms of renal cell carcinoma in preoperative period and postoperative period both, and even in metastatic period. So sunitinib, sorafenib, there are various tyrosine kinase inhibitors available for the treatment. So it can be a synchronous tumor or asynchronous tumor. Most sporadic RCC are unifocal and unilateral. If it is occurring sporadically, it will be in one kidney, most likely, not always, most likely in one kidney, and unifocal means it will be in one of the pole, mid pole, upper pole or lower pole. So sporadic will be unifocal and mostly unilateral. Bilateral involvement are feature of familial form of RCC. Familial form, as we discussed earlier, they can be bilateral involvement. So in bilateral, they can be synchronous or asynchronous, means they can present simultaneously in both kidney, or they can present one by one, or sometimes later in the one and other unit. So what are the variants of RCC? Conventional, which arises from PCT, chromophilic, which arises from PCT, chromophobe variant, which arises from cortical portion of collecting duct tumor, which arises from medullary portion of collecting duct. So chromophobe arises from the cortical portion of collecting duct tumor arises from the medullary portion. Unclassified, like renal medullary carcinoma, which is seen in especially in sickle cell disease, sarcomatoid variant. So these are the unclassified forms of renal cell carcinoma. So this is one of the variety, mucin secreting tumor. So you can see a lot of mucinous gel like material is seen after nephrectomy. So how tumor spreads, what are the modes of spread of the renal cell carcinoma? So most commonly hematogenous, then lymphatic, then contiguous spread to the adjacent organ like adrenal and surrounding colon. It can spread directly, contiguously, or thrombus, via thrombus, tumor thrombi, can travel into from renal vein to IVC to various parts. So it can spread like with the thrombus also. Now staging of renal cell carcinoma, so there were two stagings. One old one which was used in the past is Robson staging, which is stage 1, 2, 3 A, B, C and 4 A and B. So stage 1 is tumor confined to kidney. Stage 1, tumor confined to kidneys. Stage 2, tumor not confined to kidney, it has spread into the surrounding xerotas fascia also, xerotas. So stage 1 is only kidney, stage 2 is kidney and xerotas fascia. Okay. So similarly, stage 3 and 4. Stage 3 is involvement of renal vein, stage 3 involvement renal vein, IVC and both. So 3A is renal vein, 3B is IVC and 3C is both. Then stage 4, lymphatic involvement, so lymph nodal enlargement. So 4A and 4B is distant metastasis. So this is the old staging, you just remember this. Now the latest classification is based on TNM. So all malignancies are based on TNM classification. So T01234 N0 N1 M2 M0 M1. So T1 A and B are organ confined, less than 7 cm. T2 is more than 7 cm. T3A is within xerotas fascia. T3B is renal vein and subdiaphragmatic IVC. IVC below the diaphragm. T3C is IVC above diaphragm, supradiaphragmatic IVC. T4 is contiguous spread to the adrenals, like here you can see it is involving contiguous to adrenal. N1 is one node, N2 is more than one nodes, and M0 no metastasis, M1 is distant metastasis. So what are the incidence of RCC is 2-3% of all malignant neoplasm, of all adult malignant neoplasm. It is mainly disease of elderly in 6th decade, male-female ratio 3:2. Childhood RCC is not very common, but it's known. It's not like not seen at all, but is very uncommon. Childhood Wilms tumor is more common. So what are the classical, as we know, the classical triad what we used to read of renal cell carcinoma is mass, pain and hematuria. Mass, pain and hematuria. But this classical triad is seen in 10% patients only. This classical triad is seen in only 10% of cases, mass, pain and hematuria. Mostly they may present with the pain, palpable mass, PIS is bloody, means hematuria. All P you should remember, pain, palpable mass, bloody, PIS is bloody, hematuria, PUO means pyrexia of unknown origin, fever, pressure, blood pressure, hypertension they present with, pallor means anemia, and plethora, polycythemia. So these are the main clinical features of RCC. Now what are other clinical features? They may present with proteinuria and puffiness of face, like nephrotic syndrome, pulsatile secondaries, this is very characteristic of RCC, pulsatile secondaries, pathological fractures of bone, paradoxical liver involvement or Stauffer syndrome. Stauffer syndrome is non-metastatic involvement liver dysfunction, non-metastatic liver dysfunction seen in RCC. So this Stauffer syndrome is not because of metastasis of the disease. It is immunological and biochemical, only biochemical derangement, and that can be reversed with the treatment or removal of the renal unit affected by malignancy. So this is non-metastatic involvement, Stauffer syndrome, pulmonary involvement, and paraneoplastic syndrome, which is very common with RCC, like most commonly raised DSR, fever, hypercalcemia, neuromyopathy, amyloidosis. So what are the basic investigations you should do when you suspect and see a patient of renal cell carcinoma? Routine complete blood count, HB, because of you have to see anemia, urine analysis to look for any hematuria, liver function test, renal function test to see how other unit is working. Chest X-ray is very important to see if there are any secondaries, like here you can see a cannonball secondary. Ultrasound abdomen to see the location and size and number of masses, and how is the status of opposite kidney, any obvious mets. CT scan to further characterize the mass properly before planning a procedure, and for metastatic workup, and MRI angio in selected cases. As you can see in the CT scan, there is a large mass occupying the upper pole and mid pole up to the hilum. So this is a small tumor which is interpolar. See, this is upper pole, this is lower pole intact, and this is the tumor. This is the interpolar tumor or mid pole tumor. Then in large masses, especially if malignancy size is more than 10 cm, presents with lymph node, there are necrotic elements in the CT, then you should do a chest CT, which can show you lung metastasis. Like here you can see a subpleural metastasis. Brain mets are not very rare in RCC, as you can see very clearly brain mets here. Even gluteal deposits have been seen, gluteal deposits, like here you can see a thigh, there is a soft tissue deposit in the thigh. This also is not uncommon in RCC, this also can be seen in RCC. So what are the treatment modalities? Most, as I told you, RCC is a surgical disease, so surgical modality is the primarily treatment modality. Other options are radiotherapy, which is used mainly for recurrence tumor bed after removal of the kidney, nephrectomy. You can give radiotherapy tumor bed if indicated, if there is a recurrence in the fossa, renal fossa, after removal of kidney, and in bony metastasis radiotherapy can be used. as is highly immunogenic. So immunotherapy like interferon alpha, interleukin 2, and now tyrosine kinase inhibitors like sunitinib, sorafenib can be used. Chemotherapy, as I told you, has no role. Angioembolization can be done preoperatively, especially if tumor is very large and it will bleed a lot while removal, because of there will be a lot of angiogenesis. So you can put a glue or coil in the renal artery, embolize it so that your dissection and removal of the mass becomes relatively comfortable. Then other two new modalities are cryotherapy, cryosurgery, which name itself suggests it's freezing, and radio frequency ablation means heating. So as I told you, angioembolization, you can see the big coil has been kept in the renal artery to embolize the renal artery to decrease the vascularity. So cytokine therapy, what is the rationale? In the small RCCs, especially small RCCs, spontaneous remission is known, and it is very, as I told you, immunogenic. So this spontaneous remission means the renal, sometimes small RCC, small mass can remit spontaneously, and which is immunogenically, immunologically mediated. So immunotherapy or cytokine therapy is helpful. But generally cytokine therapy works better with nephrectomy. So you have to combine nephrectomy along with it or prior to it. So what are the target agents? Tyrosine kinase inhibitor agents like sorafenib, sunitinib, which are vascular endothelial growth factor, tyrosine kinase receptor inhibitors, temsirolimus, bevacizumab, which is monoclonal antibody against vascular endothelial growth factor. These are helpful in management of RCC. Which tumor responds more is clear cell. Out of all variety, the clear cell variety responds better with cytokine therapy. The new therapies like cryoablation, small tumors, you can put gas through the probes, there are various probes, and which will be at freezing temperature, it will freeze and kill the tumor by coagulation necrosis, and it is monitored via CT scan. But disadvantage is you will not get any specimen for histopathological diagnosis, and you don't know the margins of tumor. The best modality is ablation. The most commonly used, if it is localized or locally advanced, is radical nephrectomy. Radical nephrectomy involves removal of kidney along with xerota fascia plus minus adrenal and upper 2/3 of ureter. So radical nephrectomy comprises of removal of entire kidney along with xerota fascia, upper 2/3 of ureter plus lymph nodes. This will plus minus adrenal. This comprises radical nephrectomy. So other modes of nephrectomy, palliative nephrectomy, means you cannot completely cure it. You are not doing nephrectomy with intention to cure it. You don't have curative intention. You have palliation, like pain, hematuria. Because of that, you are doing a palliative nephrectomy, but disease is already metastatic in those cases where you can't achieve cure. Adjunctive nephrectomy, as an adjunct to the cytokine therapy in metastatic disease, you do adjunctive nephrectomy so that the effect of cytokine is better. Then the fourth variety, which is now most commonly being used in especially feasible malignancies, is nephron sparing surgery. So this is the radical nephrectomy specimen. You can see kidney has been removed along with entire xerota and upper 2/3 of ureter. So what is nephron sparing surgery? Means you remove only a part of kidney. Nephron sparing surgery or partial nephrectomy, also known as partial nephrectomy. You remove only a part of kidney containing tumor, not the entire kidney. But it is technically very challenging and it has a lot of complications. So we have to see where we can do or where you cannot. So nephron sparing surgery has to be done when there are tumors in bilateral kidney. You can't remove both kidneys simultaneously, or there is only single kidney and it is harboring a tumor, then you have to consider nephron sparing surgery. And you can do a relative indication of nephron sparing surgery is those predisposed to renal failure, like diabetic, hypertensive, renal artery stenosis, urolithiasis, VUR, vesicoureteral reflux disease, where patient will land up in renal failure subsequently after removal of one of the unit, then you can consider nephron sparing surgery. And electively nephron sparing surgery can be done in small renal masses. I will discuss what are SRMs in next slide. So this is the most important parameter you should know. There are a lot of parameters. These are based on CT scan to decide whether you can perform partial nephrectomy or nephron sparing surgery in that particular tumor or not. So if you don't know the details of it, that is okay, but you should know the names of it. So first and most important, most commonly used is renal nephrometry score, renal. It is named like renal cell carcinoma, renal. R is radius, what is the maximum diameter of tumor. E is whether the tumor is exophytic or endophytic. It is out, like it is projecting mainly outside kidney, just a stalk is there in kidney, or it is mainly inside the kidney. Then N, nearness of tumor to the collecting system or sinus, hilum. So renal hilum, as you know, is most important thing where you have pelvis, artery and vein. So if the tumor is, though it is small, but it is lying over the artery and vein, then you can't remove only that tumor without damaging artery and vein. And if you damage artery and vein, that whole renal unit will be compromised. So in that is a very important factor to be seen, how far and how close it is to the collecting system or sinus or hilum. Then anterior and posterior, and location relative to polar line. So if you don't know the detail, at least you know the renal nephrometry score, name should be there. Then other name you should remember is Padua, which is the synonymous for preoperative aspects and dimensions used for an anatomical classification of renal tumor in patients who are candidates for nephron sparing surgery. So whenever the question will come, and nephron sparing surgery, partial nephrectomy, you write what is partial nephrectomy, indications, what are the absolute indication, relative indication, elective indication, and how you decide upon the whether this is feasibility of partial nephrectomy by renal score, Padua score, centrality index. Don't go into detail, centrality index, just in brief, centrality index means as centrality index increases, the tumor periphery becomes more distant from the center. So as more centrality index, the more index is, the better chances of doing a partial nephrectomy, because it is away, more away from the center of the kidney, which is hilum, which contains artery, vein and pelvis. Then there is one, contact surface area. So just remember the name, renal nephrometry score, Padua, centrality index and contact surface area. So palliative therapy, what all you have to palliate? Hematuria, if there is a massive hematuria, metastatic disease, then you should do palliative nephrectomy. Bone metastasis, fossa recurrence, lung metastasis, brain metastasis, then you have to do palliative therapy, radiotherapy, cytokine therapy should be considered. As you can see, there is a big bone secondaries here. So what are the small renal masses, SRM, small renal masses? Small renal masses, 30% of them are benign. Mostly they are incidentally detected during evaluation of some other symptoms, during ultrasound. During evaluation of some other symptom, you will detect a small renal mass which is incidentally found. 30% of them are benign. To classify it as small renal mass, the size should be 3 cm. If it is above 3 cm, then it should not be called a small renal mass. It should be up to 3 cm. Since 30% away, 70% behave like RCC. They progress at the rate of 1 mm per year. 1 mm per year, generally. 1 millimeter per year is the progress rate. Less than 2% progress to metastatic disease. If it is location of mass is hilar, like in center or hilum, then partial nephrectomy is very challenging. And the one modality is observation or surveillance of the mass, how it is behaving. You don't know whether it is benign, malignant, and since its metastasis rate is very slow, so you can observe also. But before observing, you have to do biopsy of the mass. So when you are choosing observation or surveillance, then biopsy is must, which can be done with CT guided. As you can see, this is a mass, and with CT we have taken a biopsy. Now about renal cyst, these are very important. The most important classification you should know is Bosniak classification of renal cyst. Bosniak classification of renal cysts are very important. One is clear cyst. Clear, chances of malignancy is 1%. These percentages are wrong because this is the old picture I have taken. don't go by this percentage. 1%, 1-2% chance of malignancy, clear cyst. It's a clear cyst. Bosniak type 2 is with microcalcifications and 7% chances of malignancy, 7%. 2F is more dense and coarse calcification in the cyst, and 12%, 10-12% are malignant. So in 1 and 2, since chances of malignancy is less than 5%, you can just forget it, nothing will happen. But in 2F, the chances of malignancy are around 10%, so patient needs to be observed serially. Bosniak type 3 is coarse, dense calcification and septations. They are 33% chances of malignancy, 33-50% chance of malignancy. So this Bosniak 3 has to be removed, this kidney has to be removed. And depending on the type of and size of cyst, you can consider radical nephrectomy or partial or nephron sparing surgery. Type 4 is 100% malignant, that has to be behaved as type 4 Bosniak cyst should be behaved as renal cell carcinoma. So about the benign tumors, we will discuss in some other class, like oncocytoma and other tumors. So these are the basics of renal cell carcinoma. Please go through the textbook, whatever you are reading, and try to improve your theory with that. I have just given you a brief overview so that when you read, you can understand and try to understand what you are reading. And these course, what I have told you, if you don't remember also, doesn't matter. Just remember the names. That will be good enough. Okay, thank you.